welcome up on stage the actor and director who has been described by biographer York Membury as desired, as grando, as private as Alec Guinness, and as English as David Niven. The recipient of Göteborg International Film Festival's Honorary Dragon Award of 2014, Mr. Ralph Fiennes. Just before the opening ceremony, when you received this Honorary Dragon Award, I talked to a young girl outside the Drakken cinema. And I told her that you were coming, and she said, "Wow, so Lord Voldemort is in town." And I explained to her that, well, he's not always Lord Voldemort. I wanted to, my first question should be, have you felt any dark powers in Göteborg during your stay here so far?
No. None.
That's great. Now to the film. Charles Dickens, he has obviously been a key figure for your life recently, not only because you have made this film, you also acted in Great Expectations,
yeah.
Mike Newell's film that premiered in Sweden last year. Is Charles Dickens a new discovery for you, and what is it about him that made you decide to dedicate such a long time to him and his work?
Well, the first thing to say is that the reason I wanted to tell this story was not because of Charles Dickens. It might surprise you to know that I had not been made to study Dickens at school. I knew stories of Dickens from adaptations, of course, the famous David Lean films. I didn't know much about Dickens. I'd read one Dickens novel. I liked it, but I hadn't gone on to read everything he had written, but I was given this screenplay, The Invisible Woman, based on a very, very, very good biography by an English biographer, Claire Tomlin, a book of the same name. And the combination of the screenplay and the biography really moved me. It moved me because the story of Nelly moved me, particularly in the screenplay that Abby Morgan had written. She explored what it was to come to terms with a past love, a past intimacy, a past friendship, whatever you want to call it. And so what the first thing that I connected with was the idea that how someone, woman or man, comes to terms with an intense experience of love, intimacy, friendship, whatever, and if it's finished, and if it's passed, and particularly if the other person has gone and died, how you come to terms with it. Because I think every intimate relationship leaves a mark. And we, all of us, at some point, have to deal with that mark. And so that's the first thing that moved me in Abby's screenplay. And then I read Claire's book swiftly afterwards, and a whole world opened up for me. Because in her book, she describes brilliantly the dilemma, the conundrum facing women actresses in the theatre. She describes brilliantly this man, Charles Dickens, with all his different facets, different qualities. And so this combination was the thing that made me want to make it. And I was surprised because part of my head was sort of thing. I don't really know that I want to make a Victorian story, but there was a human element to do with Nelly's vulnerability as a woman that moved me. And then there was Dickens, who, funnily enough, and unless you're a Dickens expert, most people don't really know about the life of Dickens. What a complicated, difficult, controlling, gregarious, spontaneous, generous, difficult man he was. And this is what Claire's book gave me. And although that I felt strongly the film is about Nelly, it's her heart, it's what she has to negotiate. And then around her is this sort of sparkling, crazy planet called Charles Dickens. And those were the ingredients that made me want to make it.
You became the romantic hero of a generation, I think, when you did a part as Count Laszlo Almasy in The English Patient, and now you made a really great love story on your own, directed. And these are two really, like, I think, very strong films about love, and films about romance and love are always sometimes tends to be quite maybe shallow or formulaic. What is the crucial part of making love feel as it does between these characters in this film?
Well, talking about this film, one of the things I felt early on was that this love affair, and you may have felt this, I wanted to try to show the degrees by which a love affair happens. That often in films, people see each other in the first scene, and they are, and they go. And I felt this wasn't always the truth, that often people don't know that they're falling in love, whatever you want to call it. And with Abby Morgan, I tried to work on these situations where slowly, slowly, Dickens and Nelly come together. I mean, for me, it was about how do you portray the evolution of intimacy between people? And I don't just mean sexual intimacy. I mean that sense of emotional and spiritual proximity to someone, especially if, in this case, it's complicated by the fact Dickens is a married man, he has children, she's a very young girl. When they met, he was 45, she was 18. And it was a series of challenges. This story presents, if you want to make it into a film, it presented exciting challenges, which is, how do you show, given the restrictions that society imposed, how do you show that? And I don't know if it succeeds, but I know that I wanted to explore it. And the scene, for me, was a scene that Abby wrote, which I love, which is that in this middle of the film is the scene where they have counted out the money after the charity event, and they simply talk to one another, and they share information about each other's lives. And that, to me, was very intimate, before they'd even touched, really. And I feel that's something I've experienced in life, which is when you meet someone and you start to talk, you drop your sense of self or persona, and you trust. And that's something that I think, you know, it's difficult to show it in film. Film likes sort of visceral emotion, and how do you, in filmic terms, explore the delicacy of conversation that underneath which people are really opening up to each other. That was the sort of, and that's something that I mean, English Patients is, I haven't seen it for a long time, so I can't, I think very much in English Patient is a sort of, there's a lot of element of quite overt desire. I mean, I'm not sure, and this is, of course, in it's my take on it. I think Dickens had written a version of an ideal woman, and a lot of critics say his women are not real, they're sort of idealised, and I think they're probably right. But he'd written it in Little Dorrit, he'd written it in David Copperfield, in Agnes. He had taken a comedic version of it in Dora, in David Copperfield. I think what happened is that Nelly Teman walked in a room, and he suddenly saw the woman he had tried to write. He projected onto her this pure ideal. What's interesting is that Nelly is a young woman, just, you know, she's 18, she's just starting to sort of become a woman. And suddenly this man projects this thing onto her. And it's how she, of course it's flattering, it might be slightly scary, but she has to sort of come to terms with it. And it's not, and I think it was not just about desire. In The English Patient, it's a lot about something very much from here. perfectly okay. But I think Dickens, it was more more complicated. But we don't know much about. I mean, Claire's book about Nelly is a brilliant piece of detective work about what I suppose, as a man, I was intrigued by what it was for a young woman in the Victorian times to have to comprehend and come to terms with what it was to be pursued by someone like Dickens.
And for Nelly, because she's going into a quite difficult situation, obviously, and still she kind of makes it with very open eyes and a clear mind, is my perception. What is your idea of her motivation in this film?
Well, I think that the challenge of the part for Felicity, who I think is brilliant in the part, but I think a lot of it is it's a leading role that is largely a reaction. She's reacting to Dickens. I think, initially, I don't think she quite knows. I mean, Dickens's energy is quite strong. She's having to figure out what it is she has to deal with. And it's a shame Felicity's not here, because she will articulate probably better than me, as the woman, the actress playing the part. She had quite strong views on, and I think they were large. Well, we sometimes had debate, but I think Felicity quickly latched on to Nelly's armour, a sort of self-protection. How do I deal with this? I have to protect myself. I don't want to push Dickens away, nor do I want to open up. I think you see it in the performance. It's not, you see someone, it's like someone playing, holding their cards close to their chest. And Abby wrote this great, she's protecting herself. And I think Nelly did that. I think she didn't, she had to be, not only for social reasons, but for her own personal reasons. She must have had to be careful. I think she ended up being in love with Dickens, but I think it was a love full of all kinds of awkwardnesses and compromise. And at the end scene, I think Felicity plays it very beautifully, this sense of, I'm giving myself to you, but I'm having to understand that there are all these qualifications about what it means. And so, that's why some people say, being with someone is a degree of compromise. To commit yourself to another means that, you wrestle with, you have to give up some things. Total emotional, total freedom. If you are giving yourself to another, it involves this, and it involves a certain sacrifice. But I think, I'm still working out what it is, because of course we put a modern slant on it. But there must be, and this is I still think the question is interesting. Having made the film, Nelly Teman was put in a secret house. A house. Dickens put her in a house, like you see in the film. They use different names. She had to come to terms with that he would never marry her. She had to meet him on his terms. And I think he loved her, but, she had to give up something. In my question to myself is, what was that like for her? The film for me is two stories in a way. In the present day, when she's running the school, it's about how do I come to terms with the thing that I experienced with Charles Dickens, what does it, and she finally speaks in the churchyard to the priest. That's one sort of level. And the other one is, with Dickens, the journey of Nelly to saying, yes, I will be here for you. What I decided the film would not show is the life they led, I mean, for about 5 or 6 years before he died. She was in the cottage, he came and went to do his public readings. But I felt, you know, it was an interesting challenge to how you distill from a complicated biography in something into a film. And so I made a decision at some point. The film is about, one, how Nelly says yes to Dickens and commits, and two, as later Nelly, how she finds some kind of reconciliation with the memory of Dickens and how it affected her.
The Invisible Woman is your second film as a director, after the wonderful Corolianus. What was it that made you want to add this career or directing to your already so successful career as an actor?
Well, I think that I've been lucky enough to work with some great directors and see how they work, and maybe during that time I developed a curiosity about what it was to direct a film. You know, working with someone like Steven Spielberg and then Anthony Minghella or David Cronenberg, I was attracted to what I saw in them, which was the bringing together of different elements, decisions to make a film. I couldn't help but be, I mean, there are some actors that go, I don't want to direct, I'm happy just to be an actor. And then there are other actors who clearly they feel I would like to do that. A turning point for me was I made a film called The Constant Gardener, and the producer of that film. thank you. The producer of that film was a wonderful man. His name was Simon Channing Williams, and he produced all Mike Lee's films until he died about 3 years ago, sadly. He was a great man. He was funny, tenacious, brilliant producer. He had started off as an assistant director and worked his way up. He knew everything about how to put a film together. And I was in awe of the way he produced The Constant Gardener, because he, first of all, he lobbied hard to get the rights to the book. Most of Le Carre's previous books had gone to American studios, and he really pitched hard to say, let this be an independent English film. And having got it, he then succeeded in producing it in Kenya, where it was set, which was a country that did not have a strong film infrastructure at all. And I remember he went and negotiated with the tribes up in northern Kenya, where we filmed the final sequences of the film. And it was amazing to watch his integrity, his determination. And in that process, he included me, and he needn't have included me, but as a friend, as a participant. And he was the person who said to me, after some months of getting to know each other, he said, I would like to produce your first film as a director. And he had a screenplay, which I liked, and he offered it to me, and I said, I thank you, I'd like to make this film. Very sadly, although we went on location scouts to Canada, where the film was set, and we had lots of meetings and script meetings with the writer, it was commercially difficult, and being an untested director, I think that was a challenge for him. And then very sadly, he got ill, and then he passed away, very, very sadly. And I dedicate Coriolanus in the credits in his memory, because I really believe that without this man saying to me, I believe in you as potentially as a director, and giving me this little chance, it gave me the confidence to say I'd like to make Coriolanus. It was just these little experiences of going on a location scout, thinking about where you would shoot something, how you would shoot it. And it didn't go anywhere, but it just was enough to make me have the sort of craziness to say I'd like to make this Shakespeare film. That was the journey.
Talking about Shakespeare, I was reading your this biography of you the other week, and there is a wonderful quote in there that was a bit interesting for me, because you said, when you had just left the Royal Shakespeare Company, where you have been working on stage and going into film, and you said, "The thing I like about working in front of the camera is that it's as much about what isn't said as what is. Shakespeare is so language based. You have to keep going. You cannot allow pauses to sink in, or everything falls apart." And then some years later, you directed your first film, Shakespeare. What made you change your mind?
Oh dear. I suppose I actually think that Shakespeare, if he was alive today, he would love to write for film. Interestingly, a lot of his plays depend on very swift scene changes that in a theatrical sense are like cuts. If you put a Shakespeare play on, you have to move. People have to come onto the stage and take it. And in a play like Antony and Cleopatra, you go from Rome to Egypt like that. And I think there is in Shakespeare, not that he would know it, but there is a sort of narrative dynamic that is close to sort of filmic storytelling, especially in the later plays. I suppose I felt that, Coriolanus is a difficult and wordy play. It's a difficult play. It's a great text, a difficult play. But I had a feeling that if you were to cut it aggressively, you would release what I felt would be a filmically plausible political thriller with a kind of Greek tragedy at the heart of it, a sort of Oedipal tragedy at the end of it. And actually, I think probably now, I think that although I love films that have minimal dialogue, I also think film can take... I like now to see dialogue on film as well. I mean, I think there's a place for... I mean, in Corian, weirdly, Vanessa Redgrave sort of does it and proves it for me. She, as Volumnia, she has a long speech at the end of this film. And in this amazing close-up, she speaks this long speech of persuading her son to change who he is, in essence. And for me, she proves it, because it's a piece of dense verbal expression. But I see the magic of the close-up in her face, which is the emergence of fresh thoughts in the present moment in the human face, caught on film, is one of the most potent things we can experience. And it can happen without words, and in the hands of someone like Vanessa Redgrave, it can happen with a dense text, as long as it comes from here and it is present. And the best performances of Shakespeare that I've seen, whether on film or on stage, have always been where I feel that this text written 500 years ago is inhabited by an actor, and it feels completely fresh, and the thoughts and the language come out of them because they have to say it that way. For that reason, it just comes out. But of course, I recognize that the language changes, and of course, some people say, this is an old language. It isn't for me. I grew up with Shakespeare from an early age. And in English, for me, this language is alive. It's also full of experiment, and his later plays are full of experiment with English, and it risks, like modern art risks us not understanding. And I think he's been experimental with English in his later plays, and it challenges us. It's not always, I mean, Shakespeare could write, I believe he could write street dialogue very easily. In fact, there are plenty of prose scenes in Shakespeare, although they might have words that are redundant now, he's actually reflecting conversation on the street, except, of course, they're difficult for us because simple words are no longer in use, but the actual energy of speaking is of the street. He then has formal, poetic language, which is stylized. And that's the area where I think, the verse of Shakespeare is deliberately, it's not naturalistic, but there's a magic that happens when the verse, combined with an actor's true emotional inhabitation of some real, real human emotion, with that verse. So the verse becomes totally the only language that person can say. Then there's a sort of magic. And I've, you know, it's hard to achieve. But when it happens, there's nothing like it.
You have now directed two films, and even though they are both kind of tied to the classic English literature, they are so impressively different, or totally different. Like Coriolanus is like rough and violent, and while The Invisible Woman is smooth and like beautiful and classical and lucid. Do you think you will, as a director, do you think you would continue this directing those like very different films, or have you? Found your perfect fit, so to say.
No, I don't think so. I mean, I'm a beginner as a director, and but I did feel for this film, I wanted to explore a camera that was quite still, and that the framing of shots was quite specific and quite considered. I also felt that within it, it's possible to achieve. You know, there's a different kind of, not violence, I wouldn't be the wrong word, but a sort of shock of, I think, you know, the naked wife is behind the door, or the dead baby, or the pissing into the pot in the morning. And I think that there, for me, I was trying to explore what, you know, you have what seemingly is a formal camera. But actually there are these sort of human, like the first time we see Nelly, we may see her making love very quickly into the film within the first 5 or 10 minutes. You know, the urgency of her orgasm. You know, we've this beautiful speech and this thing, and I was sort of experimenting with, I felt the film needed this stillness of observation, but I wanted these punches to kind of come through. You know, I was trying things out with the cinematographer. I feel it was the right choice. I thought I did not want to try to say, when we're anxious, we're telling you a period, we're showing you a period film, therefore the camera has to be always round and moving. You know, I felt that it was an instinct in me that I felt, no, we can observe this, we can observe that. And actually, the more films that I see and films that I've been in, I love when the camera has the courage. In fact, I tell you one thing: in Coriolanus, the one shot that I perhaps loved most doing was a simple shot, which is Coriolanus is in bed. He's come home. He's wounded, and his wife comes into the room and lies on the bed next to him and puts her hand on his chest. It was a very late addition to the script, and it had to be a one-shot scene. I didn't have the time to shoot the scene and have coverage in it. And when we did it, I felt really pleased because it tells a story in one frame. She comes into the room, he's on the bed, he's in the foreground, she lies, And then Barry Ackroyd, brilliant cinematographer, did this genius thing of aligning our faces so my profile cuts her face in half and we become one face. And she puts her hand on the chest and he doesn't really react. And in that, the camera barely even moves a tiny bit. But I felt, when I did that shot, I felt, oh, that's what excites me, is that this, the frame can tell this story, and then the energy of when you come out of it is as much a part of what you've seen. And I suppose some of the thinking of that went into Invisible Woman.
But in both those films, you not only direct, you also make the main part. Is it difficult to act and direct in the same time, especially when you're in like 19th century costume?
That's very difficult.
In what way?
Well, because you have to, you know, you're, as an actor, mostly you're allowed to be ready to sit, be ready to play your part and come on and be it. And then it's a bit like I'm here with you, I'm playing a scene, and then I have to go, excuse me, to go over here. play back, okay. Now I'm in the scene again. And now I have to begin it. Cuts me off. And so it's two heads. And especially if you're with some Felicity or any other actor, you need to be guiding them, and an actor wants input, wants feedback. And sometimes I felt guilty because I would have to go and... I felt it was my responsibility to... We have the luxury nowadays of playback. Yeah. But if I was in an intense scene, like the scene I was talking about earlier with the counting of the money, on that scene I remember, they have a thing now, it's a... they call it a clamshell in England, but it's basically a radio monitor, so it's not connected, doesn't have to be plugged in. But I can be in a scene with you, and the camera's on you, and I can look at the shot on this thing. I can go, okay, it's good, okay, thank you, take it away. But so you're doing it, what I'm saying is you're doing a kind of dance, which is I need to be present with you, but then I have to, another part of my brain has to check a shot. And that's hard, you know, because the actor in me doesn't want to look at the thing. But the director in me is desperate to look at it. And there's sort of a contradiction. So you need time. You need time. Ideally, you'd like to be, okay, we've done three takes, but the time is expensive. So that the cumulative pressure of time, we have to get the shot in, I have to direct you, then I have to direct myself and check. That's all, the build-up of that is just becomes difficult. And I'd love to direct a film where I wasn't in it.
Yeah. And sometimes it almost feels like it's like Charles Dickens is directing everything
from
inside the film.
Funnily enough, you're right. You're absolutely right, because Dickens, you know, he directed plays, he loved acting, and the play that we see at the beginning of the film, he had initially produced within his own home. He was in charge of all the production design, he hired one of the great scenery painters of the day to paint the sets, and there's descriptions of him looking at the snow effects and the lighting effects, and interestingly, that play, it's a really creaky melodrama. It's not good. But when Dickens did it in 1857, 2 years before this theatre was built, he was a big success, and he invited the well-known people of the day to come and see it, and he was critics reviewed it very well. And I think what he did, he was a great director, and he produced it, directed it, and it worked. And he probably made, and I think it's true, we have him at the beginning of that rehearsal scene saying to William Collins, cut. And I've seen the manuscript of this play in New York in the library, and there are these lines through the script where Dickens was cutting it. Anyway, years later, after he died, they tried to remount this production. and it was a disaster.
As you were, well, you already mentioned a few of them, but obviously you've been working as an actor with a long row of really fantastic directors during the years. For example, Steven Spielberg and Catherine Bigelow, Wes Anderson, and I can go on forever, I think. If you just say something you learned from some of them as and brought into your own craft as a director, can you single out something like that?
Well, Anthony Minghella was often very present in my memory. He had a wonderful ability to nurture actors and also his crew by truly including their contribution. And so he had a kind of on-set energy which was extremely, it was gentle but precise in how he would ask you to look and explore other things. Also, Steven Spielberg, it was 20 years ago, now 21 almost, 21 years ago, that we made it, and I met, but I still have such a strong memory of his incredible energy on set. He hated this, any kind of lassitude, any kind of relaxation. It wasn't that he was, he was generous always, but he moved. He seemed to have an understanding that you must keep moving. But he wouldn't let go. He'd push and push and push, but with a sort of energy, which I found it thrilling, and I haven't really met it in any other director since. Which was, there's one scene where someone's interrogating me, in fact, about whether I kissed a Jewish lady in the film. And he said, keep going, go again, don't cut. I think what he wanted to do was to sort of not let me have time to regroup. So I sort of got dizzy. And then he was looking for some sort of true spontaneous thing that would happen. And I remember I had built in a little pause. I think I say, I would go, well, you know, these girls, they're so nice, and of course they came, and then he asks for a bribe, and I had decided there was a pause, so I'm going, the character's going something like, yes, of course, I wouldn't normally dream of kissing a Jewish lady, it's a matter of money. And he says, don't pause. And so I end up doing something like, well, of course, you know, I wouldn't dream of it, it's a matter of money. And it's really strong. And so it was him saying, trying to sort of mess me up in a way that made it spontaneous. And I love that. It was like, because of course actors come, we've come prepared, we've sort of rehearsed ourselves. And I think film likes some moment that's not surprising, and often the best moments are when the actor is sort of slightly out of control. And I think film likes that. It's real.
You grew up on the English countryside, and your mother was a writer, and your father was a photographer. So, which means that you, just like cinema, is like a child of literature and photography. Who did influence you the most during your childhood, like your mother the writer or your father the photographer?
Well.
That led to your career as working with cinema.
It's going to be therapy in a minute.
as and their cultural craft. That's what it was.
My mother was a great lady. She really believed in a sort of that the child must not be hindered in the child's sort of exploration of any given interest. she was the sort of lady that said, yes, if you want to go to university and academic life means something, you know, lots of mothers, well, I can remember generally parents are anxious that their children get good results, but of course they get qualified, they go and get a job. My mother was of course, that was a concern, but she sort of said, you must do what you honestly feel you can do. Don't dabble in it, but if it's not a good exam result, she would say, for me that's not important. What's important is that you follow the thing you feel truthfully and with every atom of your being. But the process towards that would be, I want to enable you to explore anything that is of interest. Of course, being a writer, we were heavily arts biased in our home. My father was he wasn't so overt in that sense, but was incredibly hardworking and dedicated man to his craft of a photographer. I think the best part of their marriage was that my father's spoke very movingly at my mother's funeral, because he acknowledged the fact that he had quite a conventional private school education, and he talked about, and I didn't know this until he talked about it, he said my mother introduced him to the Welsh poet Dylan Thomas. He didn't know about Dylan Thomas. He said it was the most amazing discovery for him to have this woman who he loved come into his life and be passionate about this poet, and he articulated that. And I think the best of their marriage was my father's. Was a strong, big man. He was a hard-working man, but he was very. It was wonderful to see him moved by my mother's passion for something like Dylan Thomas, and he spoke very movingly. So I think he sort of, in a way, gave his blessing to the way in which she would try to enable us. But he. It was a funny dynamic because she would be quite emotional sometimes, and you know, it was a vulnerability to her. So with all the sort of inspirational qualities that she gave us, she also was vulnerable emotionally. And my father was the sort of rock who would make sure that, you know, we washed up, we picked the logs up to dry in the log shed, or we did a job, or he didn't interrupt her, but he had a sort of practical presence. And I still feel that that's really important, that those simple tasks, sort of simple chores, and a precision in his craft as a photographer. It mattered to him technically. You know, he mattered to him that something in a photograph was technically precise. And for a while, my parents, when we lived in Ireland, they initiated a series of black and white postcards. Each postcard was in fact a real developed photograph. It was actually developed in a darkroom. But my mother took some of the pictures, and my father took others, and that was probably the best of their sort of creative union. My mother's eye was quite adventurous. My father's eye was quite formal. But I think they at that moment, I have a sense that they sort of bounced off of each other creatively.
What was it that made you want to become an actor?
I don't know. I think it was probably something to do with Shakespeare. I've talked about it already, but I was introduced to Shakespeare very early on, and I was very, very. He was very real to me. The language, the situations. It wasn't an academic thing. It was sort of immediate. And I went to. When I was at school, I acted in school plays, and I was told that, you know, perhaps I had some ability. But I didn't really want to be an actor, and I went to art school in London, and there was a thing called a foundation course, which is a year's course where you're as a aspiring art student, you're basically you're saying in this 1 year you can do fine art, sculpture, photography, fashion design, graphic design, and then from that you can decide where you will do a degree. But that course was designed to be quite provocative, and in that course I kind of went through some shift where I sort of decided I wanted to be an actor. And I think it was the freedom of being on an art school, actually. Because when you're in conventional amateur grammar school, which is a very, very traditional state school, but I mean, if you mention the word actor, people got nervous. You know, you had to get qualifications, and you know. Yeah. But the art school was an environment where, you know, you can try this, you can do that. Come on, just don't talk about it, do it. And so that environment, I think, sort of somehow gave me the confidence to say, I want to try and be an actor.
I think we can ask another, if you in the audience has some questions, and you're very welcome to post them.
Up here.
Yeah.
Hi. You talked. First of all, I want to say what a wonderful film it was, and it was beautiful. You talked about directing and acting, but I was wondering, do you direct yourself when you're acting and directing, or does someone else give you feedback?
No, I have.
Can everybody hear the question? Yes.
No, I have a team. I had a team. First of all, when I was doing Coriolanus, I knew it was important that I have someone to give me constructive, critical feedback on my own performance. And there's a great woman. She's primarily known as a dialect coach. She's an expert in coaching actors in different dialects. That I also think has a great intuition about performance and the truth of a performance. Her name is Joan Washington, and I met her when I was at drama school and have worked with her over the years, and I asked her to be, as it were, my guide on my own work. She also worked alongside a great script supervisor called Susanna Lenton, who I'd worked with as an actor on Constant Gardener and on The Reader, and I asked her to work on both of these films, and also Gabby Tanner, who we met earlier when we came on stage. Also, the three of these ladies were there to be wonderfully constructive, in fact. But Joan was the central woman who I looked to give me advice. And the process was that, you know, I would talk to her about the part, what I felt it should be. We would have a discussion in advance of shooting, so we had a sort of plan. And then on the day, you know, we would work and talk together, all under the kind of pressure I was talking about, to sort of get the right moment. But definitely, I would have been lost without those three women.
Thank
you. Yeah,
in
front. You've acted in such different kinds of movies, like Greenaway's The Child from Manhattan, and Made in Manhattan, and even in Steven Spielberg's and a lot of your movies. How could you go into those characters in such a human way?
Does everyone hear the question?
No. The question is, how do you manage to get into your characters in such a human way? Those characters that has been very different throughout your career.
Well, I don't know. Is it? Well, first of all, I guess there's an instinct, you know. It's a lot to do with who's directing you. Sometimes you're lost. It's an interesting question because every job is different. And it's a question of how much as they act. Sometimes you have a director who really wants to have a dialogue with you about this human element that you're talking about. And sometimes you're left alone and you don't have a dialogue. And I don't know. I'm hesitant to... Sometimes I think I've failed to engage with the right human element. And different films demand different styles, like Made in Manhattan was a commercial rom-com. To be honest, I felt very out of my element in it. I wasn't not comfortable. There were all kinds of factors that I felt were... So sometimes it's survival. You just trust your instinct to get you through. And Peter Greenaway is a brilliant man, but he does not want to engage in an act of friendly dialogue. He says, my words are just signposts for ideas, which is great, but you know, if you're trying to inhabit this human element, that's not very helpful. So what I'm saying is you can be admiring of the director, but sometimes you have to bridge the gap. Because often what the dialogue, you may admire them, be happy to be there, but a meaningful dialogue about the interior journey often isn't given you. And actually, why should it be? Sometimes it's your job to do it yourself. And sometimes a director can want to have that meaningful dialogue and it's not helpful, because they don't know how to do it. So, you know, it's six of one, half a dozen of the other, and sometimes it all works, and sometimes what's interesting is an understanding happens. It's not even about speech, it's just you do a take again and again, you're finding your way, the director doesn't know how to help you, but when you get there, they go, yes, yes, that's it. And so often it's sort of awkward, and it's about what you fail to say, sort of you find a way just through doing it. Anthony Minghella is very precise and wanted to have a precise dialogue and feel his involvement with you. Sometimes it was great, sometimes I wanted to say, Anthony, please, no, let me. And how much of that is my own neurosis, or is it a true, you know, you don't know. I often think that the actor's brain is closer to a sports person's brain. I'm not an athlete at all, but I think that you have to be absolutely present, and you don't want to... Analysis is a tiny part. Often it's you just want to feel yourself dropping into the moment as much as you can, and it doesn't matter whether you have a very, very intellectually fastidious director like Peter Greenaway. You can have a guy who's quite shy, but you feel his sensitivity, like Wayne Wang, who did Made in Manhattan. And you can have someone who's really wants to engage with a coherent actor's dialogue like Anthony Minghella. There's always going to be a place where neither way is right. It's just that you're always looking for this peculiar thing, and often it's given to you. You have to allow. In fact, I suppose I would finish this whole thing by saying, when I auditioned for drama school for RADA, there was a wonderful man called Hugh Crutwell, who was the principal, and I did my, in fact, it was like a Hamlet monologue. He said, yes, 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 I think you have some potential, but you're making it happen. You should not make it happen, you should let it happen. And I always remember one of the best acting lessons I've ever had, which is some sense of allowing something to happen. And often, however good or indifferent or bad or helpful a director is, in the end, the actor has to allow it out.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
And again, we are very happy to have you here. And once again, Congratulations to the
Thank you very much.